Hello, and in this video we'll study the general notion of a norm on a vector space X. And in its most general form, a norm on X is a real valued function which satisfies the three axioms stated here. The first one of the axioms requires that the norm has a non-negative value for every element X of the vector space, and that the norm is equal to zero precisely if X is the zero element. And the second axiom requires that scaling of an element X with the scalar alpha likewise scales the size of the norm X with the absolute value of the scalar alpha. And finally, the third axiom requires that the norm satisfies the so-called triangle inequality, which states that the norm of a sum of two elements X and Y is always less than or equal to the sum of the norms of these two elements. And the pair consisting of the vector space X and the norm satisfying these axioms is then called a normed space. The main uses for a norm are that it allows us to, in a sensible manner, define and discuss the size of an element, namely the norm of an element X on a vector space, and as well the distance between two elements defined as the norm of X minus Y. And the forms of all of these three axioms should already be quite familiar, because they're precisely the fundamental properties of the norm on the Euclidean spaces Rn and Cn. And indeed, these spaces are particular examples of normed linear spaces. And usually in linear algebra, we would be considering these spaces with together with the standard Euclidean norm shown here. But there are also other choices of norms available on these spaces, a couple of these options are shown here in the slide as well. And it's worthwhile to note that even though with these different choices of the norms, the vector space Cn stays the same, all of these different norms give rise to distinct normed spaces. For us, more interesting cases arise when we equip particular infinite dimensional vector spaces with norms. And if we begin by considering sequence spaces, we can first of all note that the space of all sequences of complex numbers is quite a bit too large for defining a norm, but instead we can define norms on some of its subspaces that we've already considered. And for example, the space L infinity of bounded sequences has a norm which is defined as the supremum of the absolute values of the elements in the sequence. And this value is well defined since, by assumption and the definition of the space L infinity, these absolute values are uniformly bounded with respect to the index k. And on the other hand, the space LP of p-summable sequences, in this space we can define a norm by taking the sum of the pth powers of all of the absolute values of the elements in the sequence, and then taking the pth root of this infinite sum. And when we study this norm in detail, we'll see that this pth root on the outside of the infinite sum is really essential for the scaling property in axiom 2 of the norm to hold. And it is also important for the triangle inequality in axiom 3 to be satisfied. And we can first take a closer look at the space L infinity of bounded sequences and show that this infinity norm is indeed a norm. The values of the norm are indeed non-negative, and the zero sequence with all zero elements has the norm equal to zero, as it should. And finally, if the infinity norm of a sequence X is equal to zero, then by definition, the absolute values of the elements in the sequence have an upper bound which is equal to zero. And this can only happen if all of these absolute values are equal to zero, which means that all of the elements are zero as well, and X is then the zero sequence. To prove axiom 2, we can let X and alpha be arbitrary and simply write down the definition of the infinity norm for the alpha times X. And we can modify this expression, and since the modulus of alpha is independent of the index k, we can take alpha out of the supremum. And this leads to the absolute value of alpha times the infinity norm of x, which indeed shows that the scaling property in axiom 2 holds. And finally, to prove axiom number 3, we can take two arbitrary vectors x and y, and again write down the definition of the infinity norm of x plus y. And using the triangle inequality for the absolute value of two complex numbers in each of the elements of the sequence, we can estimate this expression, and we can further estimate it by using the subadditive property of the supremum. And then we very quickly arrive at the estimate which shows us that the triangle inequality is satisfied for the infinity norm. And now that we've verified all of the three axioms, we can deduce that L infinity is indeed a normed space when we equip it with the infinity norm. On the other hand, in the space of p-summable sequences, verifying the first two axioms is quite straightforward. And on the other hand, in the case where p is strictly greater than 1, the triangle inequality requires a bit more work. And this property of the p-norm follows from a separate result called the Minkowski inequality for sequences. And the complete proofs for this inequality, and as well as the two other axioms, are given in the lecture notes. And indeed, the space LP of p-summable sequences is a normed space together with the p-norm. We can then turn to our other class of vector spaces of interest, namely function spaces. the space of continuous functions on a closed interval from A to B can be equipped with several different types of norms. And particular examples include the infinity norm, which takes the supremum of the absolute values of the function f at all points on the interval. Alternatively, we can define the p norm, which integrates the pth power of the absolute value of f over the interval from a to b, and then takes the pth root of this value. And since our interval from a to b is assumed to be closed, we can immediately note that both of these norms have well-defined values for all functions in the space. And actually, the supremum in the infinity norm could just as well be replaced with maximum, but we will stick with supremum for consistency. And as an additional note, as the notation here suggests, there's a definite parallel nature between the infinite and p norms for infinite sequences in the previous slides and the norms defined for functions on this slide. And in particular, in the case of the p norm, the main difference is that the norm for the sequences was defined by an infinite summation, and for functions, this norm is defined instead by integration. And proving that the space C functions on the interval, closed interval from A to B, becomes a normed space with either the infinity norm or the one norm are left as exercise problems. And in the case where p is strictly greater than 1, the first two axioms are again quite straightforward to verify, and the based on simply the property that f is assumed to be a continuous function. This is a crucial property here. And like in the case of sequences, the triangle inequality requires a bit more work. And this result is again covered by a separate result in real analysis called the Minkowski inequality for integrals. And finally, the previous example has a natural generalization to the spaces of functions of several variables when we consider the space of functions which are continuous on a closed and bounded subset omega of Rn. Again, these functions are uniformly continuous, and the norms defined here have well-defined values for all functions on this space. And as before, the first two axioms are quite straightforward to check, and the triangle inequality for the p-norm follows from a more general version of the Minkowski inequality.